I would like to continue where Solo finished, the very last slide. And what I would like to do is to apply this notion of legitimacy and legacy, legality, to the issues I raised earlier. And those issues will come up on the front. Just to record, I am more concerned than any of you under a worst-case scenario. For me, the notion of preventing a major war is not necessarily just focusing on that issue, but on focusing on what I call the existential, the face, the governance, and the health of mindset layers of the crisis. Okay, so how to apply legitimacy and legality to those notions. Let me start with a quote which was made on 1st of March, 1933. And the quote is, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." Okay? This quote, so many times recited since then, was from President Roosevelt, FDR, on the very day of his inauguration. On the day of his inauguration, at a moment when two-thirds of the U.S. banks nationally were closed, when the Federal Reserve, the Fed, closed, 50% of the production was evaporated as a result of the crisis, unemployment, tens of millions at 25%. So this is the moment when he spoke about face. And this is a reminder. This is a reminder about the importance of focusing not necessarily on the top of these layers, but focusing more on the bottom one. Roosevelt was elected on a platform which was not calling for what is today the notion of qualitative ease. Okay? Compared to Hoover, he did not want to throw more money. It's very interesting. And it's bringing up the first question of legitimacy. Because what he did right after his election was, yes, a Weizmann program of relief, reform, and recovery. At the same time, what is interesting, that program did not cost huge amounts of money. So the deficit ratio to the GDP went up under Hoover 250% during the Hoover years, 250%. To 40%, okay? Under Roosevelt, for the first 8 years of his presidency until 1941, it stayed practically at 40%, okay? So the issue was not necessarily injecting huge amounts of money to address the banking and currency and default with the injection of qualitative ease means. But the question was, and this is what he did, he was reassuring the U.S. population as a population that he understands that there is an unemployment problem, there is a problem with the homeless, there is a problem with social justice and fairness. Okay? And this is what he was handling more at the psychological level, and he was communicating directly with the people. His fireside chats were a reminder of what he was doing. If you go back, my notion is the global New Deal, okay? So I am stealing the notion from Roosevelt, from FDR, the New Deal. But Roosevelt himself stole the deal notion from Theodore Roosevelt, because there was a square deal, okay? So the platform of Theodore Roosevelt was square deal. And this square deal platform meant practically pretty much the same notions what was FDR promoting, social justice, fairness in the more fairness in the distribution of the wealth, and to regulate what is to be regulated. And I would like to quickly come back to that point. The interesting element as well that these two leaders, okay, I call them leaders, not politicians, these two leaders defied the gravity of their time. And I myself consider that in my narrow area, I have failed, together with all my colleagues, to defy the gravity of nuclear weapons. I admit. There was yesterday an interesting discussion, and I didn't have the time to make the point, how far we are able to see what might be utopia versus realism, or what might be what Igor called black and white, okay? And I admit that I failed because we could, and I could not bend the reality. And these leaders did bend the reality, okay? They did bend the reality. To give an example about Theodore Roosevelt, again, he didn't have the legitimacy necessarily, because he was an accidental president. McKinley was shot, and this is how the vice president, Roosevelt, became the president. So he was not elected on his platform. Okay? So what he did, for many, he was a trust buster. I think he was more a trust regulator. But even if we call him a trust regulator, he practically picked up a fight on the railway trust with a group of investors headed by J.P. Morgan, okay? The capitalization level of that trust was, if I try to translate into today's value, was at least $100 billion capitalization, if not closer to $150 billion. No capitalization level like that exists today, okay? And that economy was 116 years ago at that capitalization level, okay? So this is the fight he picked up. And he picked up a fight with Standard Oil, with Rockefeller. By the way, Rockefeller called the Morgan Wells that he's not a rich man. But these are the words of Rockefeller when he was looking upon the Morgan Wells. He picked up a fight with Standard Oil, and he fought it successfully. And he picked up some fight on arbitrating some labor capital dispute, coal miners, and he went into the conservation, the biggest ever conservation effort in the U.S. or the national parks, that because of Theodore Roosevelt are there. So this is the time he went after the railway affairs, and he went after other major corruption, a huge effort to tackle corruption. But he was defying the gravity of the time. Okay? From a McKinley point of view, what he was doing was utopia. Okay? And he delivered turning it into a reality. But the interesting question is, and this is bringing us to the issue of legality, that both Roosevelts were criticized and called dictators. Okay? Both of them. FDR, because he was trying to pack the Supreme Court with allies, which was not true of his. And Theodore Roosevelt, because he was using, and you hear this notion, executive orders on a scale where all the presidents before him did not accumulate as many executive orders, 25 presidents, as Theodore Roosevelt, okay? And it was, yes, it was in a circumvention of the gravity represented by the establishment. The interesting element is here, of course, What is a narrow path? There is a very narrow path here, okay? Because what happened, there were politicians breathing in the neck of both FDR and Theodore Roosevelt. Radical ideas, more extreme ideas. One example is Bryan from the turn of the century, who was going much, much beyond where Theodore Roosevelt went. And in the case of FDR, there was a politician who was shot. His name is Long, in 1935. And he was going far, far beyond where Roosevelt was going. Beyond him, there were extreme ideas. Father Coughlin was the name of the priest, who had 30 million listeners on the radio, by the way. So these were very, very extreme ideas. So on one hand, these leaders defied the very strict interpretation of legitimacy. For some, they were walking a very narrow path between legality and lack of legality, but they were doing it in the right way. And in my judgment, this is what had us with what did not happen, at least in the United States, compared to what happened, what Emily described so clearly, what happened in Europe. Okay? And this is a message, because today some countries would be happy to have only 25% unemployment. Some countries would be happy only 40% of the debt ratio compared to the GDP. Okay? So we have a much bigger problem, but again, this is about the second layer, which we will have to address, and this is not requiring huge amounts of money. Thank you.